spend my nights out in the barroom. Liquor was the only love I'd known. But you rescued me from reaching for the bottom and brought me back, being too far gone. You're as smooth.
Hey, that sounds so self-familiar to you, Doug?
Yes, it does.
Hey, brother, we put it on. We usually have one that's called a Mimolo, which was equivalent to the Frank Sinatra I Did It My Way. It's a banda song, but I go, you know what? We're going to play this one for you from Tennessee, brother, all the way from over there, man.
Got to watch him sing that live here in Knoxville.
Oh, I'm sure you have, man, without a doubt. Yeah. I've seen him twice in concert, one in Fort Lauderdale and one here in Tampa. But, guys, with that said, we want to give Ishmael welcome to the show, brother. We got all the way from San Jose, California, 408 Sanjo, and we got our brother. Steve, this brother right here did, I believe, 24 years at Pelican Bay. He worked the security squad, I believe, for the majority of his time that he was there. He was known as the Batman of Pelican Bay. He's watching you right now all the way from Tahiti. He's watching you from all the way over there. No, not Tahiti. Thailand. He's watching us from Thailand, and I believe it's like 5 o'clock in the morning. Welcome, Dim Jajanis. Welcome, brother. So,
hi, Jim.
Hey, Bobby, what's going on, man? How you doing?
Doing good. It's heating up here. It's going to be 100 degrees on Monday. So we'll hit the
century. Oh, my God. Well, so, we got hit with 90 degrees over here in Fort Lauderdale. And, guys, we have our special guest tonight. We have Steve Duncan, but we have our co-host, another San Diego PD legend, Doug Collier. You've been with us several times on the Gray Line. This is the first time on Ash Wednesday. Yep. Welcome to the show, brother. And I know that you're going to introduce Steve. But, Steve, once again, brother, welcome to the show. We're excited to have you with us. I was talking to Chris Kilby. Told me that I guess you guys still get together at Jamba Juice one day during the week, once a month. He says, he calls you Stevie Duncan. Well, you know why, because he's like 6'4", right? He goes, when Stevie shows up and we ask him anything about the cartels, he goes, it's like E.F. Hutton talking. Everybody shuts up and lets him talk. He goes, he could talk for an hour, and we're all just glued listening to him. With that said, brother, welcome to the show. But, guys, before we get started, Doug, we'll start off with you, brother. What are you drinking tonight?
I've got Angel's Envy tonight.
Well, that's a good one.
And I've got it in the glass. Oh, let me see. I got to figure out this computer. So this is the Red Griffin, and it's from Waterloo PD in Iowa. And Kim's sister-in-law's father is a retired captain from there, and he sent this to us. And it's a Red Griffin. It used to be on their patches. But there was some controversy over it, and so now it's no longer there. But we've got one of the original glasses.
Wow. Wow, that is so cool. Bobby, before we get to you, Chalo, former chief of police from Calexico and the host of our show, The Gray Line, he's watching us today. And a quick message for you, Doug. Doug and I met when we were working in Herat, Afghanistan.
Yes.
You remember that?
I do. In fact, he was on the team that met us at the airport because we flew in and he took us back to the camp because we had to do some follow-ups on some guys that were in custody and do some interviews. And he met us out there and introduced us to some of the guys so we could go do our interviews. He and my partner, Noel.
What a small world, huh?
It's a very small world.
Small world, brother. Bobby, what do you drink? You're the only one here smoking because you know what? You're not like me. I'm on the lawn. My wife will not let me smoke in the house, but you do smoke in the house. What are you smoking, my man?
I'm smoking a Jaime Garcia Especial. Right here. I love this cigar. And I'm drinking this cigar is one of my favorites. You mentioned you were in Afghanistan. I was in Iraq for 2 years, so I used to get these boxes shipped to me over there, and we'd be sitting outside at night smoking cigars, running to the bunkers in between indirect fire being shot at us every night. So it was good smokes. And the tequila, I'm having a Siete Leguas. It's a Siete Leguas tequila. I left the bottle in the other room, but that's what I'm drinking, the Blanco.
We got Luis Bernal. Que onda, veterano? Saludos. Very, very good work, guys. Thanks for your service and also for sharing your stories. I'm sipping on Johnny Walker Black Label on the rocks. Salud, Luis. Salud. Steve, what are you drinking? Tell us about the beer that you're drinking and where you got it from and where somebody, if they want to buy it, where they can buy it from.
This is a metallic blue one. It's from the Gold Brewery. It's partially owned by my son-in-law. He's the head brewer there. He's world famous. His name is Derek Galanosa from San Diego. And it's a hazy petite Indian pale ale.
Wow. It is a brewery there in San Diego?
Yes. He had a brewery called Moxa in Sacramento, and Brian Perry did an article on him.
Really? Wow. You know what? Maybe we could have him on our show one of these days. You think he'll come on Ash Wednesday and talk about the beer and just chit-chat with us while we're smoking our cigars? Hopefully he'll have a standard working.
Oh, yeah. Ooh. You could get a nice angle on beer because this guy travels the world making it with doing collaborations with people. And I'm telling you, the guy's world famous.
Really?
Yeah.
Cool, man.
I have really good son-in-laws. I have one that's a musician and he sings at the bars and venues, and I have one that makes beer.
It doesn't get better than that. You go watch him sing and you get drunk, right?
Yeah.
Hey, guys, go ahead.
No, I better shut up.
hey, guys, you know what? Before we get started, we've already said what we're drinking, but I want to basically just talk about one of my very good friends. And I know Doug, you got to know him, and Steve, I know without a doubt, if you remember him or not, that in one of your arrests and one of your investigations, you had to touch this man's arm. Rest in peace, my brother Alex de Armas. End of watch was yesterday morning. Suffered from cancer. And I'm telling you, this man is one of those guys, Steve, like you, that you know what? If somebody needs your shirt, he will literally take off his shirt without exaggeration and give you his shirt, give you his shoes. And now he's part of God's army, and he's now protecting us. Alex, we honor you, brother. Salud, guys, to Alex. May you rest in peace, brother. We will see you again very soon. God bless you. Good man. And by the way, Doug, I'm drinking a Resilient. It's called Resilient, age 14 years. And wow. I bought this in Chattanooga. We went to Nashville for Thanksgiving, and I went to one of the local bars there, or one of the liquor stores, and I go, tell me, what are you guys famous for? And he goes, Resilient. And he had, this was the last bottle he had stacked. He wanted to price, sell it to me double the price. I go, no. He started laughing. He goes, man, I'll give you a price. And he started laughing. But I don't know if you heard about it or not. It's, I guess they make it in Chattanooga.
Yeah, I have heard about it, but I haven't had a chance to taste it.
It's not that great. It's not that great. Hey, brother, with that said, we got Big Joe, saludos from Salinas, and we got San Diego PD legend, man, Chris Kilby, Stevie D, and D Fresh on the podcast. Let's go. I can listen to these guys all day long. And the last Chris. One, Roger Demshock. Good evening, men. Hi, Steve. Big Roger.
Hi, Roger.
All right. All yours, Doug.
All right. Well, tonight I got invited to be a co-host with my good friend there, Steve Duncan. Steve was a former probation officer in San Diego County. And then he went to Department of Justice in California with, I believe, the Bureau of Narcotic Enforcement. Is that correct, Steve?
Yes.
And he ended up retiring as a special agent. But I never worked with Steve when he was at NTF and working narcotics, but when he was a gang probation officer, he was on a unit called the Gang Suppression Unit. And he and I got to work a lot together, became good friends. And even on those, when I'm in town in San Diego, I get a chance to see him every once in a while down at the Friday Jamba Juices. And it's it's a pleasure to have him on the show, and I'm really looking forward to hearing about all the AFO information and how it may be related to a certain movie we're going to talk about. So
Hi, Doug. Say hi to Kim.
I will. In fact, she's sitting right next to me here.
Hi, Kim.
Hello.
She says hello.
She's probably embarrassed. Hey, Steve, before you get started, Bobby, tell us about the movie, and then let's rock and roll.
Well, the movie, when it came out, really touched a lot of us that were working drugs. At the time, I mentioned before on prior podcast, I was at ground zero when the cocaine and the crack cocaine explosion hit the streets of Phoenix. I was a young cop working the streets, walking beat the city housing projects where I grew up, running around, and it hit like, just like in the movie. I watched the movie yesterday, and it's like, it just brings back those memories when we were working the street and seeing people, because I born and raised in Phoenix, I started seeing people that I grew up with were messed up on coke. Girls that, you know, back then I was in a buy, when I got to NARCS, I was in a buy squad, and I was doing street level buys and going into a house and having women totally nude or just in her panties in a bed in a small little apartment with all these drug people selling dope, and she's a dope whore. Girls that you would see a couple of months earlier looking clean, and now they were there. And it was, when I saw the movie Traffic yesterday, it reminded me of those scenes that I would walk into a house and see these women just selling themselves. I mean, I was making snitches out of guys I played football and baseball with as a growing up here in Phoenix, because it seems like it hit everybody. So many people got hooked on that. And then one final observation I made is, I remember we hit a search warrant in Paradise Valley, and I thought we were at the wrong house because the house was way too nice. And we walk into the house, and wow, I think we're in the wrong location. When you go to the bedroom where the son was living, it was in another country, it seemed like, because the mom had no idea what her son was doing, and he had a pound and a half of coke in a locker in a safe in his bedroom. He pointed an Uzi at the entry team. He was lucky to get killed. So to me, I think what happened was when the cocaine explosion hit, just like in the movie that we saw, that I watched yesterday, is it hit all segments of society, rich, poor, the inner city, the nice areas of town, the suburbs. It hit everywhere. And I think that's where, to me, it just seemed like there was a generation that was lost. And then now we have the same thing that's happening with the fentanyl, with the opioid, the fentanyl addiction, except now tons of people are killing or dying from it. So that was one of the observations I had from the movie. And working in Mexico, I saw the corruption. I saw the incompetence from our side, from our bosses. And I always felt, I saw one of your podcast interviews there, Steve, and you gave me PTSD just watching, because it brought back those memories that I had to deal with incompetent bosses, that I felt doing the job was the easy part. Maneuvering around some of these bosses that had other motives to try and make themselves look good, and they gave rat's ass about us. And when I saw that interview, I sent that interview that I saw that you did with David to tons of my friends. We talked about it over coffee because it was like, wow, I thought that only happened at Phoenix PD, but it happens everywhere. So yeah. I give the floor to you.
Yes, you know, I always used to think I was unique in that I had that issue with my agency, but I'm not unique. I know that everybody does, and everybody handles it, you know, and handles it different ways. You know, it just, yeah, it was the biggest challenge of the job. You know, it wasn't the corruptness in Mexico. It wasn't the U.S. Attorney's Office. It was, you know, the people you work with, some of the people you work with, because we had a lot of
right.
Really good agents. We were just top heavy with idiots where I worked. What's that?
One other point I wanted to make. I met you, Steve, when it was a California gang task force meetings that we, Phoenix guys, would go to California. I met you in San Diego, and you did a case study on the AFOs. You know, you talked about the Arellano Felix, and we're sitting there listening to this, amazed, because we had them in Phoenix at one time before Sinaloa kicked them out. We used to run into a lot of AFO influence in Phoenix. And when we watched that, I mentioned earlier, you had some of those wanted posters, and I thought that would be an awesome wanted poster for my man cave. And you gave me this. You gave me, here it is right there. And here it is here in my my office. And I ended up getting two of them. I think you gave one to another guy. And that one eventually ended up.
Hey, Bobby, say the truth. Boston. Say the truth, Bobby. You stole the other one. Say the truth.
I stole the other one. I go, hey, look, there's Santa Claus. And everybody turned around because everybody was drunk. And I ran off with it. But because, you know, they used to have those open, the happy hour afterwards. So the
were you with the Armando?
Soldati. The Armando Soldati.
Yeah.
Yes, I was with Armando.
Good dude, yeah.
So what happened was that, yeah, awesome, man. He was our MA guy, man, our MA guy. And anyway, so what happened was that the other poster right now is in the office of the chief of narcotics in the Brčko district of Bosnia. He attended a undercover narcotics school that me and a retired narcotics lieutenant from Sarasota, Florida put on. And I spent 3 years there. And before I left, he loved American law enforcement. He was a good ally of ours. And I gave him the other one. So the other one, as of last year, that poster is in his office. So let's get some use out of it.
Hey, Steve, tell us about the movie, man. When it first came out, where were you? And were you asked to be one of the advisors of the movie? Tell us about it and how it compares to the Arellano Cartel.
You know, I don't think any of us were asked to be advisors at really? The time. I remember when it went out because we took a field trip, me and the other case agents on the case, Dave Harrod and Jack Robertson, the father of our case, and others. We went to the movie theater in Grossmont, I remember, and we watched it as a part of work. And I really enjoyed it. You know, it's TV, so they changed some things. You know, and I always say, in when you're telling a story about this type of organization, you don't have to make things up. You know, you really don't, because unbelievable things happen. I mean, you guys are all cops. You know that. There's just so many stories. And, you know, when they make it up, it just, you know, it takes away from the movie. But I really did enjoy the movie, especially the parts in Mexico. You know, when you know, I just liked the way it switched back and forth, United States and to Mexico. And I really liked the parts in Mexico. Fascinated me.
Steve, I would have swore that it was either one of you, Dave Herod, or one of you guys that was the advisor. Because, I mean, they hit the nail in the head with a lot of the people that they were portraying, specifically the Arellanos, Kitty Paez. A lot of the guys, plus it was filmed in San Diego, and they had Tijuana there. But I'm really surprised. I forgot to ask you. I should have asked you that before the show. I thought for sure that you were probably one of the advisors.
No, you know, in those days, they wouldn't let us talk to the press. I remember Chris Blatchford always used to try to talk to us, you know, because he was always doing these investigative reports in L.A., And he would call and I'd say, I'm not allowed to talk to you. You have to go through the PIO or, you know, the public information officer. But then at some point they started letting us talk to the press. And you know, that's when I first started talking to the press, talking to guys like Chris Blatchford that really cared about what was going on in the world and did some great, you know, great investigative reporting. You know, and I always worked with the San Diego Union journalists, Sandra Dibble and what's the other, Anna Curley. So I always worked with them and met with them just to make them, you know, to keep them safer, you know, maybe not give them specific information, but generic information, because they were reporters that had to live in Mexico. But at times I was allowed to talk to the press. And I think it's important that we do, especially in San Diego, where we tend to focus on certain things and not focus on things that are really important, like lately, the cross-border violence in San Diego. You know, we've had two cartel murders in the last month and a half, you know, and so there was absolutely no reporting on that until recently. So, and you have to remind them, you know, and that, you know, this is important. This affects us, you know, the country that where they have 2000, I mean, that city where they have 2000 murders a year right across the fence from us. And compared to us with our 100, where you're 70 times more likely to die stepping across the border, you don't get that. You don't get that important information from our news media. It's they tend to follow the flavor of the month and whatever's political on the left, you know. So I did bring that to their attention. I was a part of that article that came out in the San Diego Union last Sunday, but that kind of stuff concerns me because, you know, it's happened. It's happened to us over the years, that spillover violence where you get these shootings with automatic weapons or, you know, the players that are getting killed or people that you've been following around that you've had, you know, on your radar that you write about your reports that you're targeting. And so it's happening again in San Diego. It's only two, but it's just very important for law enforcement and the prosecutor's office to get together and the feds to get together and figure it out. And I think they are. I think they're doing a really good job. I'm not a cop anymore, so I don't know any of the inside scoop, but it does concern me, and I still follow it. I still follow that stuff. You know, I have a spreadsheet of every cartel member that lives in San Diego over the past three decades because, you know, I think it's very important for cops to know if they're patrol cops, any cop, to know if they're approaching a certain house or area or individual that he has been trained by the cartel or he has been exposed to, you know, what they do.
Hey, Steve, from somebody from San Diego PD, for example, one of our detectives are working criminal intelligence that's monitoring the cartels. Would you be open to share with them that information? An active cop, an active detective?
Oh, definitely. And I do. And I do. I do. I, you know, I think I know who you're talking about, and I love her dearly. Mm-hmm. And we keep in touch. We're friends, you know. So she comes to our Enrique Camarena functions, and she supports the foundation. So,
yeah.
And we've been friends for a very long time and for sharing information for a very long time.
Yeah. Hey, go ahead, Doug. Yeah, Steve, when you were with GSU probation, did you work the gangs that you were assigned to, was it mostly Logan and down in that area? And is that how you became involved with the AFO?
Kind of. I had 92102.
Oh, okay.
And 92113.
Right.
In fact, one of the cases where I really got to know you was some 5'9 guys that lived in East San Diego.
Yeah.
And I can't remember their names. They were brothers. They were notorious. And I walked in their house and there was a million of them in there and I was scared to death. And I think you guys came and pulled me out of there. And I remember, and we found a bunch of weed and packaging material. And I remember going to court and watching you testify as a gang and a narcotics expert. And I was just fascinated with your resume, you know, and I was intimidated too. I go, God, I don't think I could ever do that. Cause you just nailed, you know, every training you ever had. And, you know, it was great. Yeah.
I remember, you know, I mean, I never worked. I only worked majors for a year, and that was late in my career. And so I didn't really have the same experiences that you did working, you know, the international majors like you did. But even in the realm that I was, is like in weekend and SED, GST, and then as a working in the gang unit, I mean, it didn't matter what gang it was, whether it was Asian or Black or Hispanic, all the dope was coming from the guys that you were investigating.
It's crazy. Isn't it? I mean, we used to, you know, I helped with Operation Red Rag and Blue Rag and Moco Rag and whatever rag.
Lucky Strike.
And I was, and, you know, Pat Burse, you had me on a leash, and, you know, and I would do all the bail reviews.
Yeah.
I would go down to the DA's office after work and, you know, and write these little reviews saying these guys are too dangerous to be bailed, you know? And so, and I violated a lot of the guys. So I was a part of his pack, you know? So I got to hang around with the cool guys. And went as a probation officer, when I went over to NTF in 1992,
right?
I was the mindset of working black gangs. And I ran into a guy named Steve Paez. And Steve Paez, brand new agent. He's from San Diego. He had been a marshal. And I remember his first day on the job in San Diego as a new probation officer, and he was assigned to our group. And he asked me, he goes, I want to do a case. You know, I need to get an informant. Can you help me? And I go, yeah, you know what I do? You know what I do every day is I go down to the mail. Back then we had mail, you know, the hard cut. I'd go down to the mail room and I'd look at all the tips and I'd take all the good ones and then I'd bring it back and I would work those, you know. And so we got this one and we did this big gang project where we got this this female Crip that she was probably the one of the top rock cocaine sales ladies in San Diego. Her name is Tega Johnson. And she worked with a girl named Debbie Miles. And these girls would go to LA and they would buy powder cocaine from the Grape Street Crips, bring it down, and they would rock it up in the microwave. And so we got this tip about her. Her husband was pissed. He was in jail. He gave us the information. We went did a fourth waiver on her house, and we got, you know, a whole bunch of crack, and she had two previous convictions. So she was looking at life. And so she helped us out, and she could buy from anybody. And I remember sitting across from her in the office, and I say, I want you to make a buy from Nolan Reese. He tried to kill a cop.
Right.
You know, there was an incident, I don't know when, but I heard it at one of the gang meetings that he ambushed a cop and the gun didn't go off.
Which gang set was he from, Steve?
Little Africa. Hmm. Yeah. And so like, he was like, you know, I knew who all the shitheads were. And I basically told her, you need to buy from this guy, and she could buy from anybody. So she'd sit in the office and call anybody, you know, that was moving weight, and she would either sell to them or buy from them. And so we ended up, and we had video in her car, audio video in the car. You know, I learned that from Black and Blue Rag. And we ended up taking down 35 high level black drug traffickers and a couple white guys, a couple Mexican guys with lower level buys. But when we arrested all those guys, they were all looking at anywhere from 10 years to 20 years to life, because we did them federally.
Right.
And so they all cooperated, of course. And like Doug said, every one of their, some old Mexican guy around the corner. Is he gangster? No. You know, so you know, that's when I learned, you know, 1993, you know, and then when the Arellanos, the Tijuana guys, started recruiting gang members, I knew all those guys from juvenile hall and from camp and from probation, and you know, supervising them, because I had that area code. And the DEA agent that had the case at the time, Jack Robertson, who later on did Lance Armstrong, great guy, wonderful, what a story that guy has. He asked me to help out with his case, you know, and he had an informant down there who is in custody at MCC right now. He was recently extradited with Maito Gordo. At the time, he was our informant. And he was telling us that there were gang members from Logan Heights in Tijuana working with David Barone, killing people, you know, hunting down Chapo Guzman. You know, this is 92, 93. And so he would give me the street names, and I would go to you guys,
yeah,
San Diego PD, and you guys would give me the real names. And so Jack, through me, developed a partnership with the San Diego PD. So you guys were in at the very, very, and back then it was Herge and Sanchez.
Right.
Yeah. And Herge would call me every morning, what do you got? What do you got? What do you got? Because he got a stat for all my probation violators, you know? Yeah.
Another one, may you rest in peace. Yeah. Hey, Steve, real quick, let me just throw a quick shout out. Guys, if you guys love to hear oldies, those of you that are watching the show right now, you have, well, you definitely have YouTube because you're watching our channel today. One of the best oldie shows over here in Tampa every Sunday or sometimes at night, Mr. Oldies. Please, if you love oldies, if you love Art LeBeau, if you love all Wolfman Jack, this is the new Art LeBeau. Make sure that you subscribe to his channel. best oldies in the world. I'll sit out here in the bay, smoke my cigar, have my scotch, listening to you at least 2 days a week, three nights a week. Oldies, Mr. Oldies. So please subscribe to his channel, outstanding channel. And Bobby, I'm trying to get him to come on so he could talk about the music with us. With that said, go ahead, Steve Dispensa.
That's basically it. I know that sometimes I'm long-winded and I go on.
No. Perfect.
It brings me back.
Well, yeah, and that's why I asked, because I mean, I think it's important for people to understand, and cops in general. Like for me personally, you know, I started off thinking that I wanted to work dope as a young officer, and it morphed into gangs for me. And it started off with black gangs, and then it morphed into Asian gangs was what I really enjoyed working. So it's nice to hear how, you know, as a young officer or probation officer or special agent, you know, what you start off with isn't necessarily what you end up at.
Right. It's crazy.
And it's interesting how the trajectory of your career goes and how you end up working cases. And that's why I asked if you started off working, you know, those areas before you went to work. And then you became so involved in the AFO organization, you know, investigations. To me, that's fascinating how that works.
Yeah. Herky used to just rattle my cage, him and Herky especially. He goes, Steve, there's all kinds of shit going on right now. There's grenades being passed around the neighborhood. Yeah. There's these shootings with the AK-47s, and there's all kinds of stuff going. And it's Logan Heights. You know, they've been really quiet, but, you know, they're hooked up. Something's going on. And you have the time and the resources to do it over there. So you need, and he told me, you need to do that. You need to take advantage of that. And I was scared because I was a probation officer working with a bunch of narcs, but I realized after a while that, you know, I was better trained in other areas than they were. And, you know, I could write, you know, I could take notes, I could listen. You know, probation really prepared me well for working these types of cases because, you know, after a while it became historical because all of our crooks were in Mexico and they were safeguarded and, you know, they paid off everybody. And, you know, we had to do historical cases and they were too high up to get them on the phone or, you know, in the usual ways, you know, so we had to, you know, arrest people and get them to cooperate, mm-hmm. you know, arrest people, get them to cooperate, you know? So, you know, when Jack Robertson told me that he needed help, he goes, listen, I want you to mess with any Logan guys you can. Hi, Loopy. And
Coach Duncan, you know, he's calling you coach. You knew him in Juvenile Hall, right? He's calling you coach, Steve?
Yeah. I hope I was good to you, Loopy. I think I, you know, at the time I had an identity crisis. You know, we all thought we were badasses sometimes, and I the kids used to call me Richard Simmons. You know, and they were brutally honest, those juveniles. You know, I had this afro and these big thick set glasses, and I used to wear these short shorts, and you know, they would just tell it like it is. You know, so but anyway, you probably remember me, RDC. Okay, Loopy. I think I know who you are, Loopy.
hey, Steve, one question from Big Joe, 67, I believe, from San Jose. Thank you for your years of service, Sir Duncan. How high in the Arellano cartel was David Barron from Logan Heights?
You know, he was very high. He was very close to Benjamin, who was the head of the organization. He led an enforcement group along with Ramon Arellano Felix. David had his own enforcement group. He had a lot of guys that worked under him. But, you know, he was a guy that was very ambitious, very loyal. He didn't use dope when he went down there. He had rules and regulations. And when they asked him to kill somebody, he did it, and he did it well. And so he was talking to all the main guys. You know, we go by radio transmission. So he was talking directly to the top level guys. You know, and to this day, you know, he was great friends with Kitty Paez and Ramon, Benjamin. He was up there. He was up there just below the top.
So to kind of get back on the movie part of it, I watched it again. I'd forgotten how good the movie actually was. So I watched it again the other day to prepare for tonight. And I really enjoyed it. And like you said, I enjoyed the parts where they were talking when they were in Mexico. It was different filming and different things. And I just thought it was more raw.
Yes, exactly. But
how accurate? I mean, did we actually have people in La Jolla? And it cracks me up when they say, you know, La Jolla, California, because it's San Diego. La Jolla is just a small community within the city of San Diego.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's a very exclusive area, obviously. It's a lot of money up there. But
we have people in La Jolla right now.
Yeah, that's all pretty accurate as far as working directly with the organizations.
Yeah, they may have changed the names in some of the stories, but you know, in particular, one of the main characters, Alejandro Orellan,
that was
arrested, and then he was tortured and beat down and then brought up again by General Salazar, who was General Robollo in real life.
Right.
And General Robollo was helping us because we had a common enemy. Robollo was sent. Yeah.
He was a Mexican drug czar at the time. Mexican drug czar.
Yeah. And so Robollo actually gave us Alejandro Orellan. You know, and in the movie, Benicio del Toro, who's in every cartel movie I know, and does a great job. Yeah. He goes into a bar dressed as a alternate lifestyle person. I don't want to offend anybody out there. And he picks up Alejandro Orellan. And they take him, and he takes him to Salazar, where he gets tortured, and then Salazar gives him to us. And that's happened before, you know, where we really want somebody. And there were times when I come to you guys, you'd have him kidnapped down there and brought to me. I hate to put it like that, but it's kind of like what it was. You guys had such good contacts down there.
Not,
you know,
the game guys. CIU guys, you know, did it.
Being told to go down to the port of entry, and there's a guy with a bag over his head in the back of the car.
And, you know, on that, I have to say,
what the hell am I doing here? You know,
when I was first assigned to as a patrol officer in San Ysidro, I got a radio call of a man that got dumped over the border. It was gagged and tied, and I got there, and there he was. And it was probably about 30 minutes later, I had a bunch of federal agents there, and they took custody of the guy. So I'm sure he was one of the bag guys that got dumped across the border, and a radio call suspiciously came in.
Yeah, it was back in the old days. I don't know if they could pull that off anymore.
Hey, Steve, before we get to Chalo Gonzalez's or Chalo, the Chief's question, tell us a little bit about Kitty Paez. I mean, was he, who portrayed him? Was he portrayed in the movie? If not, tell us who he is. Was he really the one that recruited David Barron?
It wasn't Kitty per se. It was his brother. Okay. His brother and Gustavo Rivera Martinez were in FCI Phoenix. In the late 1980s, David had been arrested by the San Diego PD with an assault rifle. And he was on parole at the time for killing, you know, the 68-year-old transsexual, and was done federally and sent to federal prison for about 3 or 4 or 5 years. And when he went there, he was a sureño, you know, he was on his way to becoming a brother. And so he took under his wing Kitty's brother, and I don't remember what Kitty's brother's name is, either Oscar or Robert, and Gustavo Rivera. He met them there. Gustavo Rivera had worked with Javier Caro Payan, El Doctor, who was the predecessor of the Arellano Felix brothers. You know, and he was, him and Gus were arrested for 8 tons of weed. that they stored at your friend's house, David, Bob, the guy with the blonde hair. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So anyways, but they were doing time for that. And David just kind of took them under his wing and showed them the ropes and kind of protected them and watched over them in prison. And they told him, when you get out, you got a place with us. And I remember, and Gus and Kitty's brother. And then when David went to TJ, he was down there part of the time because he was illegal. He was still doing stuff here. You know, he was moving a lot of coke, tons of coke. He was moving hundreds of pounds of meth. And, you know, he knew how to make it. He learned a lot of things in the institutions. But they asked him to join them. And then they started asking him to kill people in the United States because they didn't want any heat in Tijuana because things were good back in those days. So from 1991, you know, through the time of his death, he was killing people in the United States or having people killed in the United States. But Dave initially did it by himself, and he did it well without any heat. So that's one of the reasons why he became more and more respected. And then, you know, when the incident in Christine Discotheque in Puerto Vallarta, where he helped save the brothers escape a massacre from Chapo's guys, he became a hero to them and was taken aside and told, you're going to be the head of my enforcement, and I need guys like you. And so he dipped into the Logan Heights guys.
And where did Kitty Paez come into?
Oh, Kitty. Yeah, Kitty. I'm sorry. Yeah, Kitty was a narco junior. He was he grew up in Tijuana. You know, smart kid, funny kid, ambitious. And he had a lot of the same qualities as David, except he wasn't as mean and ugly. And, you know, he didn't have the temper, you know, that he had. He was more of a, you know, a clean, you know, preppy. But Arturo ran all the cocaine in the U.S. that was coming in from Colombia, that was moving through Mexico and coming into the United States and into Los Angeles. Kitty was handling the distribution of cocaine. And he got David and Gus to open a business in San Diego, and they would buy and sell these big trucks. And they would equip the trucks with these panels where they could put like 400 or 500 kilos of coke. And they'd bring it in through Tecate, and, you know, they would have quads and everything to make it look like they were doing their, sand stuff, you know, so bring it in that way. And we seized about 3 or 4 of those loads, large loads, and the vehicles were traced back to David and Gus, to his business, to his homes, you know, variations of his names. So I think David caught wind in the fact that we were following him around, because everybody was following him around at the time. We had an OCDEF case back at that time. And so he went south. Now, he was enamored with Kitty, you know, because Kitty was just, you know, just very charming, dressed nice. So he started dressing like Kitty. And these are words that came from Juan Felix, you know, after we arrested Juan Felix. You know, Juan was David's main guy in San Diego, you know, so that's Juan. And so when we arrested Juan, you know, and he's looking at life in prison because he's, you know, he's violent, dangerous, and had so many priors. He told us, you know, initially he said he wasn't going to talk about David. He'd talk about anybody else. And we just said, you know, screw you, dude. You're rot in jail. And so, okay, I'll talk about him. But then the bastard didn't talk about some of the murders that he did. So I remember going later on, and when I found out he did some murders that he didn't tell us about when he had the opportunity to, I told the U.S. Attorney's Office, and they didn't do anything about it. But Juan told us a lot about Kitty, how David adored him, how they became compadres. They were always together in TJ. You know, when Kitty got arrested, he cooperated with us and told us, you know, about 100 murders. A lot of them that David did, told us how they were close. Kitty was very close. You know, Kitty went into the program, got out. And we met with him a couple times.
Yes, we did.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so you know his personality, very endearing, very charming, funny. Mm-hmm. But you know, he was one of those guys that was a businessman. He wasn't a drug user. You know, a lot of people don't understand that, you know, guys that make it big in the cartel are not drug users. And when they do start using their own product, that's when they go downhill. So, you know, he was out of the same mold. He just wasn't as evil as David. And he wasn't really a killer. He had to kill to be a part of those people. But, you know, and I remember him telling me and Dave Harrod, you know, damn, why didn't I meet you guys, you know, when I was 16 and 17? Why couldn't somebody just slap me in the side of the head and tell me to go straight, you know? I didn't have anybody like that, you know? So,
but Steve, what happened to him? Last time when we got together, we had dinner with him. We talked for hours.
Yeah.
And then I didn't see him again. Whatever happened to him? Is he still alive? Is he doing time? What happened?
He's still alive. He was relocated in the United States. Mm-hmm. And I haven't heard from him. Oh, well, I've heard from him, but I'm not at liberty to say.
He's doing well.
Right.
He's doing well, not in prison.
Alive.
He's doing well.
He's alive, okay. Dave.
Okay. Yeah.
That's all I can say.
Steve, tell us about Ramon Arellano. Everybody sees him. When people see the movie The Godfather, they think that he's Sonny Corleone. Was he Sonny Corleone? Tell us about Ramon.
He had a very hot temper, very hot temper. It was a show off. And he killed people for sport. If he felt slighted by somebody, he'd kill them, you know, and we all know guys like that, you know? But he was very vengeful towards the Sinaloa guys, you know, first and foremost, Chapo's guy, Raya Lopez, who he killed, the one that stole an Adina from the ranch back in the 80s. You know, he's personally executed him. He spent most of his time traveling Mexico to find Chapo and Mayo and Amado and Guadalupama and anybody associated with those guys. So that's what he did. And he took guys like Night Owl with him from Pozole. He took a lot of guys with him to do these things, a lot of paisas, but some of the gangsters. And, you know, some of this stuff I learned years later, you know, who was there and, you know, what happened and who they killed and for what reason. But Ramon was the guy that he would have these scenarios. He would set up these scenarios in Ensenada in the wine country, and they would practice ambushing Chapo as he came to his ranch in Sinaloa, you know. So, you know, they would have snipers and, you know, a cleanup crew, and, you know, so he was a tactical guy. He liked that kind of stuff. I mean, if he was a cop, he'd be, you know, a SWAT guy, I guess. He wasn't very cerebral. You know, Benjamin and Eduardo were the ones that were cerebral, more businesslike. Yeah, but so, Ramon was an ass. Ramon was an asshole.
So are you saying SWAT guys aren't very cerebral?
In this case.
Yeah. Well, I know one thing. Not all of them are proactive. And Ramon was very proactive, right?
Yeah, exactly.
They're all waiting for that code 11. That's code right. 11. They're all waiting for that.
Hey, Steve, I'd like to ask you it's kind of a personal question, but I only lasted for like a year in the majors. And we got a new puppy, and he's a crazy little dog. He's an Australian Shepherd, and he's 4 months old, so he likes to hang with us. But anyways, I only lasted for about a year on a wire team that did majors, and we were doing a lot of the Mexican, the cartels type stuff, and working with Haida teams out of LA and stuff. This is when I was up in Riverside as a DA.
Oh yeah. Yeah. You guys did some good stuff up there.
Yeah. But we never arrested anybody. We arrested like three guys in a year, and we let everybody go to keep the lines up so we could get to the next level up. And every day I would read the paper or read news articles, and I would see guys being hung from the bridges, guys being found headless. And I always thought to myself, are these the guys that we just took off that we got, you know, $50,000 worth of cash off of them, and like, you know, 3 tons of weed, or, you know, 8 kilos of coke or heroin? Are these those guys that we didn't book? They had to go back to Mexico and explain themselves. Are we responsible for their deaths? Did that ever, like?
No, like, we're not responsible for their deaths. They make.
No, we're not. We're not. But I mean, that was like that was.
Well, yeah, it could like, be an offshoot of taking their shit and them not, and letting them go.
Right. That was that was my thing. Was like if we arrested them, then. If we don't arrest them, then it looks like they're an informant or they're like giving up information and then exactly. They're called back in and then, you know, they're off. And these guys were not informants. They were just, it was just a more of us keeping them
strategy.
Yeah. Keeping the lines open. And that's why I left. In my mind, I could not get over that. How did you deal with that kind of stuff?
I thought it was cool. And I heard about it later, you know, it's like you took our dope, you know, and Gus called us all on the carpet, you know, because we took their dope, let everybody go. And, you know, Gus being a snitch himself, he called everybody on the carpet, you know.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell's going on? Somebody's working here, you know, and if David were alive, you'd be dead, you know. And
right.
Because there are no. You know, there are no, what's the word I'm using for, looking for? There are no.
No honor among thieves.
No, there is, you know, when it wasn't a chance situation, basically.
Right.
You know, he didn't believe in coincidences. Yeah. Coincidences. Yeah. So he knew that something was up.
I work.
Go ahead, Bobby.
I worked Title Threes, the wiretaps, for about 7 years, the last seven of my career. So we used to hear those calls. We'd take a load off, and all of a sudden, some call would come from Mexico where El Señor wants to talk to you, and you need to, you guys need to come over and explain why you're losing so many loads. And we'd hear the calls where they're calling each other. Do you think, don't even think about that. Do you think that, you know, and I know there were times where people would leave and they would disappear. And it's just part of the business. I mean, I imagine a lot of people die a horrific death. You know, that's drug trafficking is not for sissies, for sure. You know, you get in that business and you're going to run into some, as far as these bad guys, they're going to get, you know, they're going to, here in Phoenix, we used to have bodies dumped all the time. They would just kill them here. And one of the things on San Diego, after I left, I was in Mexico for 3 years, running the as a regional manager for the Merida program. What a joke that was. And running the Merida program, I got there and we did develop some very good sources, but our bosses were all career state diplomats who never worked law enforcement, who really hated us, didn't like us. And they were there just to have a vacation, really. But when I left Mexico, I got a job writing for Breitbart News. I was writing about the cartels for 2.5 years. I started digging a lot into the numbers of Tijuana. It's probably 2019. They had 2,518 homicides in Tijuana that one year. And I had contacts that were working for the Procuraduría, the prosecutor's office, that I could call. And I was in Tijuana a lot of myself when I was working in Mexico. And the thing is, they're telling us, you know, in talking with the prosecutors, the investigators, they go, we solve maybe 5% of our homicides. So there's mass murders running around there. Imagine this. And those guys get up, they got work to put in. They run up some incredible body counts. And then for people to think, well, I hope this violence doesn't spill over. Hell, I was a cop in the 80s. It's been spilling over since the 80s. Yeah. I was a cop.
Yeah.
It's happening. Yeah, it's happening. And they're here. They live among us.
Doug, to answer your question about do these guys, the people you hear hung on the bridges, were they the ones that you released? Let me give you a quick scenario. This is a true life story. In 2019, right before I left San Diego to move to Fort Lauderdale, one of the reasons why I sold my business to my business partner, Oscar Armenta, probably it was in 2018, probably I believe it was like in October, November. We had clients throughout Mexico, and there was one exclusive hotel in Tijuana where we would meet high-level clients, like Julio Cesar Chavez. We'd meet, you know, high-level clients. We'd meet them there. We had one attorney that we worked with, and we knew this attorney was high-level, but we also knew that he had ties not only to the political, to the government, but also to the crooks. One day he calls us, says, I want to meet you guys. I have a client I want you to meet. We told him before you bring the client, come in. We'll sit down over coffee at this hotel and tell us about the client. The guy shows up like on time. Oscar and I are sitting there waiting for him. He walks in with his beautiful suit. As he's walking in, right before he sits down, I go, hey, ¿cómo está? ¿Cómo está, licenciado? You know, I shook his hand. We actually hugged. We always hugged. And he goes, I'm sorry. And he walked away. When he did that, I mean, literally, man, my skin, I mean, I'm immediately looking around. And as he did that, all of a sudden, two SUVs, black SUVs, drive up. They drive up right to the front door. We're sitting over here, but it's a hotel, exclusive hotel. There's a coffee shop here. We're sitting here. We have a view of the front door. As we see that, they drive up. He goes and he walks away. I look at Oscar. I go, it's too late to run. It's too late to run. Let's see what's up. You know what I mean? I thought it was a hit for us.
Right.
At that moment, guy opens the door and he's dressed all in black. And we thought they were federales at first. He opens the door and out of the back door, this guy comes out and he has a cowboy. Well, it's not a Pendleton, but a checkered shirt. Levi's, they're dirty. They're not even clean Levi's and chanclas. He walks out. His hair's messed up. And he walks out, they point him toward us, and he's walking toward us. As he's walking toward us, I look at Oscar, I go, it ain't Chapo. We started laughing, but at the same time, we're scared, right? You know, us cops, we make jokes out of everything, right?
Right.
It ain't Chapo. I go, I don't know who he is. He comes up, he sits down, and he goes, Señor Contreras. I go, sí, señor, a sus órdenes. Shake the man's hand. He goes, Armenta, señor Armenta, sí, señor, a sus órdenes. Can we sit with you? Claro, señor. Mucho gusto. He sits down. Everybody, the guys, one's at the door, one's literally standing like directly behind him, and the rest are in the vehicles. He sits down and he goes, I heard both of you were cops. And we look at him. We go, yes, we were. I work for the San Diego Police Department. And he goes, you're private investigators here in Mexico. Yes, we are. I need your help. I go, okay, well, first of all, who are you? He goes, it doesn't matter who I am. He goes, I come from Sinaloa, just like that. I mean, and the guy even spoke, you know, the videos that we have at Chapo spoke like that. He wasn't an educated individual. Right. He wasn't Mayo Zambada's son, in other words. This guy was literally from the hills. And he goes, I got some paper. And he takes out a paperwork, and he had a receipt of somebody that had been released, picked up, released with, I believe it was $30,000 and a specific amount of drugs. And he goes, you know what this is? The R&I form?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what this is? I go, yes. And he goes, one of my guys is in Culiacan right now. And he handed me this. And they released him. He goes, I swear to God. He goes, they released him. And he goes, did he tell? I go, first of all, you're asking the wrong person. If he did or not, I can't find out. I'm not telling him. I'm not going to tell him, which I'm not. But right. I'm telling him, I'm already building up my case. I can't find out because I'm no longer a cop. He goes, I don't care how much you charge me. I just want to find out how much money they took. I go, it says right here. He goes, I don't believe that. And I want to know how much dope. It didn't say the amount. How much dope was taken. And I go, why? He goes, because he said that he got arrested in Santa Ana and they released him. And now he's back home and we don't believe him. He goes, he's alive because of this paper. He goes, I don't care how much you charge me. I want you to tell me what exactly happened. At that moment, I'm looking at him. I'm looking at Oscar. And I go, we can't tell you. I go, what I can tell you is this. Is he released? Yes. Did he tell? I don't know if he did. I go, I doubt it. Because I know the minute I say he did, he's dead, him and his family. So the minute he said, did he tell? I mean, right away, his eyes opened up. And I go, I can't tell you if he did or not. I go, but I don't think he did. Especially if they released him, he went right back to you with this paper. I go, what probably is happening is it's probably a wire case. They're probably listening to him. They released him because later on they're going to go arrest him and maybe 25, 30 other guys. And he goes, they do that? I go, yes, they do that all the time. And he goes, oh, okay, that makes sense. I go, yeah, they released them. I go, but there's probably going to be a warrant, but not now, but maybe in 3 months, 4 months. I'm trying to talk my way out of there because I want to leave, right? And then he goes, well, Mr. Contreras, I have your phone number here. He goes, I'll pay you whatever you want. I need to find out. He goes, his life is in your hands. I need to find out how much money was taken and how much product was taken. And I go, okay, I'll get back to you. And he goes, don't get back to me. Get back to, and then he mentioned the name of the attorney. Out of respect, I won't mention him. We walked away. That attorney for about a month kept calling me, David, you need to come back. They want to meet with you. And finally, I said, you know what? We're not going back. I go, it's over. Well, they don't know. They don't take no as for an answer. I go, it's over. I go, and we didn't call anybody from DEA. We didn't call. It was none of our business. First of all, we're not cops. We're not going to share that information. But Second of all, that man's blood's not going to be in my hands. So does it happen? Yes, it does. And who do they hire? Dirty cops or private investigators that are now working in Mexico. Now, those guys that you see hung are probably not the same ones. These guys that you see hung probably ripped somebody off in Tijuana, Matamoros. It's very rare. The guys, how they kill them, they set them on fire, or they basically make pozole. They don't make them an example like the guys that they throw over the bridges. So none of the guys that were hung were part of your arrest. So sleep good tonight, brother.
I'm glad because I only lasted on that team for a year. Yeah. And I was like, man, we were, in my mind, we were nothing more than a sanctioned rip team. We were taking more dope and more money than you can possibly imagine. It was amazing. And we, in 1 year, we only booked three guys. And I'm like, what the hell are we doing? Because I wasn't part of the big, investigative team that was like doing all this stuff. I was working majors, but I was still, they put me there to still work the gang stuff, the street gang stuff. I wasn't there to work the cartels. But I was part of that team. So when we went out to do operations, I was part of that team. And in my mind, I couldn't even imagine. I was like, how are we not booking this guy? How are we leaving him out there? And then I would read those articles and it was like, and that's why I was asking Steve, because I was like, and if you're working those majors, if you're actually the major guy, which I never was, you have a different perspective than I did. So I ended up going back to a gang task force because it was like, in gangs, it was very simple. You do a shooting, you go to freaking jail. You're selling dope, you go to jail. There's none of this. Or you become an informant. I mean, depending on what your liability is on cases.
Yeah.
But there was none of that. We're waiting to get the guy at the top. And that's why I was asking Steve that question, because I could never come to grasp with that. And that was just me personally. I understand people can, but I just couldn't do it because I'd never worked that before.
Steve, we have a question for you from Ed to Tom. Does Steve know when Gus Rivera will face trial for his crimes? And is Gus Rivera now in the United States, Steve, or is he still in Mexico? I know that you were part of the team that caught him, right?
Yeah, he was arrested in Los Morelos outside of on the East Cape, Cabo, below Cabo in 2008. I think it was the night before Easter. You know, we set up on his Easter vacation home, Semana Santa, and took him off on the way to the home. We had been there for a couple months, so we were following him around, identifying his properties, and he always traveled alone. But he was arrested. He claimed dual citizenship that night. He was flown to Mexico City in late 2019, right before COVID. He was extradited with Mayito Gordo, Mayo Zambada's son. And they went to his hearing together. And I was there for the first two or three hearings because I wanted Gus to see that I was there, that I hadn't given up on the case, even though I was retired. But Gus Rivera, we initiated the case on Gus Rivera. Because of, at one time he was helping us, and then he tried to screw us, and we made it our business to get him. And we took down everybody below him and made them and they cooperated against him. So we have a very good case for drug trafficking against him. And we indicted him in 2002. Now in 2004, when we started listening to the entire radio system of the Arellano Felix organization, we know that he committed a lot of murders. He had morphed into a basically a drug trafficker, well, just like the other Arellanos, into a hitman or a hit squad. You know, his team was responsible for killing Franco Ortiz, the Zeta editor, and you know, in 2004. And we know that because the head of the organization, when he cooperated, told us that. And so, you know, part of my days are spent with the information that I have, trying to reach out that to people, sometimes in Mexico, to give them closure, you know, to like, you know, like Alfredo Orellan in the movie Traffic, right? Frankie Flowers, that was his name. So we got him here. We wanted him to cooperate against his brother who killed the Attorney General of Mexico. He wouldn't do it. So he fled the hotel we had him in. He went back south. Ismael Higuita Guerrero had him picked up, brought to him, and they tortured him, beat him, pulled his fingernails out, and dissolved him in acid. Now, for years, his mother, Alessio, has started a group to find their missing loved ones.
Yeah.
In 2008, when Ismael Higuita Guerrero was extradited with his brother, Gilberto, they admitted to killing Orellan and dissolving him in acid. So it was at that point we called in Alejandro's mom and told her at the U.S. Attorney's office. I remember a lot of the agents sitting around the table with a U.S. attorney, and we told her that we didn't say how he was killed, but that we just wanted to give her some closure that he's not coming back and there's no remains. But that kind of information we've learned over the decades. You know, we were told by everybody that's ever cooperated, and they all do, about the people they kill. That's one of the questions we have. Who'd you kill? You know, in their proffer session, they'll give you a list of people they can talk about who they kill. You know, Franco Ortiz was one of those, you know, and I think it's very important to the Zeta publication that they know, because I know that they were on a wild goose chase with Nalon, Armando Villarreal, saying that he did it. Because I think they got a false police report from one of the cops working for the other side, you know, at one point. You know, I've been talking to the editors there for the last couple of years, trying to give them some closure. But I think for them, it's you know, it's hard for them to accept it, you know. But there's so many things we've learned over the years from these guys that we really never acted on, because they happened in Mexico. Although we did share it with the Mexican government. Yeah. But you know, hell, when I was working, Dave, we were working with Genaro Garcia Luna.
Yes.
You know, he was doing great things for us, mm-hmm. but the fucker was dirty as hell. You know, so, yeah, so, I mean, you know, part of my time is spent trying to reach out to people to give them closure, because we have so much information that, you know, we're focused on indicting the next big fish, or, you know, getting Javier on the boat, or, you know, whoever. And a lot of this information goes to waste. You know, we share it. You know, I'm really good at sharing information, because I think it's important for officer safety first and foremost, but also for the victims. Yeah, that's part of what I do these days.
Steve, when you see this picture, tell us what you see and who are these guys?
Those are Logan gang members dressed up in the same suit to take their PGR credential photos. And that's those are Calle 30 guys.
Yeah.
There's Pato Quiñones. There's David Barone's brother-in-law. There's Melvin Gutierrez. There's Joker from Calle 30. There's
Not Jimmy.
There's Nacho.
Nacho.
Guy that dissolved a bunch of people in acid that was dating the prison guard at Donovan, Selena Estrada, and talking to her over the radio. This is Turi. Turi is a fugitive in a case of ours from 1996. This is Sailor. Sailor got whacked about five years ago. And this is Flips. Flips is a fugitive from a 1990 homicide in National City. He was found unfit to go to trial. They sent him to Camarillo. He walked away from Camarillo, joined the Barón and the Pato and the enforcers, and has killed hundreds of people.
Steve, I don't recognize this one right here from the bottom, a second up from the right. Who is he? I don't recognize him. With a mustache?
Oh, the bald guy?
Yeah, with a mustache.
He was a paisa. I think he was a Mexican cop.
I didn't recognize him. I recognized Melvin, all the rest of them. Pato.
Yeah.
Nacho, so, yeah.
The top right-hand corner is one of David's brother-in-laws. You know how his sisters were married to crooks, and they were all part of the organization, all of them. And they're here in the United States right now. Tell me about it. These are primarily Logan guys that worked for Pato, initially worked for David, and then worked for Pato when David died. And this is probably 2000, 2001, they were taking their credential photos. And we had a guy that was really pissed at the Arellanos, call our hotline and ended up selling us discs of all the organization's PGR photos. Wow. And so we got about 100 of them, and we actually put them on the internet. It was called Narc Tip at the time, and the FBI did it because the DEA didn't want to pay for it. In fact, the day we met with the guy that was going to give us these things, he called our hotline. So when somebody calls our hotline and wants to meet with us, we bring a bunch of guys out. So we brought about 10 guys, and we were in between Neiman Marcus and that other high-end store in Fashion Valley. And we were in the outside coffee shop meeting with the guy, and we were on the terrace and around, you know, watching the meeting. And we realized at the time that we were being watched by 15 young Mexican kids, and they looked armed. So we called our UC that was meeting with the guy who was showing him the pictures, and we bailed out. This is in 2003, I think, but I think it was actually the Palillos that were trying to sell us the photos. And they became so frustrated with federal law enforcement because we didn't act on it right away that they ended up taking matters into their own hands and started whacking people here, you know? So there's a lot of that, you know, a lot of stories, you know, and, you know, you don't always remember them all, but it's just, you know, I guess part of staying involved for me is, you know, continuing to track, you know, these people and the violence and teaching and but also giving people closure.
Steve, Chris Kilby, this will be the last question. Could you see that Mexican Independence Day Mariachi Festival in Logan Heights? Can you talk about that?
Oh yeah. You know, and that's we threw down to San Diego PD. I was in the academy at the time, DOJ Academy. You know, I was going from being a PO to a special agent with Cal DOJ. I was 39 years old, you know, going through the academy. I was like Jethro graduating from the sixth grade. But anyways, at the time, we had an operation going on in Logan Heights. And we had an informant named Big Mac. And Big Mac had a camera and audio visual in his car. And we were buying dope from all the Logan gangbangers and recording it, and we were going to do the sweep, you know, at the end of the operation. But I told Big Mac, I go, on days when nobody's got dope, just go buy a couple six packs and take them and drive them around, get drunk, and we'll videotape it or tape it. So on one day, Tarzan and Spanky, not this Spanky, but this is Spanky. But Spanky was Spooks' little brother. Book was murdered in prison after he turned himself in for the murder of the cardinal. Spanky, a genius that he is, even after the Arellanos left it, hung his brother out to dry, ended up joining them. So one day we have Tarzan and we have Spanky in the back seat, and Max asking him questions, and they're talking about what they did down in Mexico working for the Arellanos, and, you know, some of the criminal stuff they were involved in. So we had that all recorded. And so we were doing this operation at the time, buying dope, getting intel, trying to build our case on the gang members that murdered the cardinal, that were recruited. Now, shortly after those recordings, Tarzan gets called back by David. David's sister, Claudia, drives him down to TJ. He meets David or Pato at the cab stand. They go in a car, go to the safe house. Tarzan starts doing shit again, you know, murders and whatever. And Spanky gets arrested for kidnapping Sirach Boloyan, who was a rich man in Tijuana. He gets caught doing that. We got him talking about that on the tape. And we end up arresting him before he could rejoin the group. We're doing that at the time. I go to the academy at DOJ, and I get a call from my partner, FBI agent, Britt Johnson. Great guy, funnier than shit. But anyways, Britt tells me, he goes, hey, Big Mac met up with Pee Wee Jarboe and Tarzan at the Mexican Independence Day at Memorial. And they're on their way to kill Yogi from Teresa. Because Yogi talks shit to his sister, Gloria, or Lizard Eyes, Marissa, at Chewy's. Chewy's at the time was a meeting place for the Logan Heights guys at 28th and Main. And so David sent these two guys to kill him. And they're on their way to do it. They're going to do it with knives. And they're driving a brown Audi with the headlight out. And so... Brett is eating Thanksgiving dinner, or he's eating dinner or something like that, because I was reading the transcripts. Brett calls our contact, our gang detective contacts, and the thing I think was J.C. Smith. He calls J.C. Smith, and he goes, hey, listen, I'm up at home in San Marcos. Big Mac just ran into these, Tarzan and Pee Wee at the, and they're up from TJ, and they're going to kill Yogi from Trece. Logan Trece, and this is the car they're in. So JC calls GST, of course, and it's Kilby and Krawczyk, I think, at the time, that are out and about. So they start looking for the vehicle. I don't think they were told much about what these guys were going to do. You know, it was basically stop the car. Didn't tell them there were going to be knives in there and that they were on their way to do a hit and they might, you know, fight back. So there was none of that officer safety conversation. And so JC gets a hold of GST. GST is out looking, you know, it's shit, tons of people. It's like a needle in a haystack. But they find the vehicle. Kilby finds the vehicle at 28th and, it's a little Marisco shop. And the vehicle's parked there. When it leaves, they do a stop on it. They pull up. They take the two guys. They put them in the back of a unit, handcuff them, and they put the recorder on in the unit. And they find knives. They find black clothing in the back that these guys are going to wear. Still, they don't know what these guys were doing. So they're just doing us a favor. We use that incident, the attempted murder of Yogi, in our case against Barone, our case against the Cardinal. It was one of our overt acts that occurred in furtherance of the organization. And so years later, when the U.S. attorney calls Krawczyk and Chris for indictment review, grand jury prep, they find out that they stopped two assassins for the Arellanos who had killed multiple people without knowing why they were stopping them.
And they prevented a murder.
And I remember Kilby cornering me and just telling me, this, you know what, Duncan, you need to talk to your people. You know, and that wasn't the first time this stuff happens. You know, sometimes these feds, they're from another world, you know, and they don't understand the streets. They don't understand the, you know, the sharing of information, the courtesy, that, you know, they're just the courtesy of, hey, watch yourselves. These guys are, you know, so, but anyways, yeah, Kilby hit me up and I got word to my people.
Hey, Steve, I said that was going to be the last question before I'll probably ask you one more question apiece, but I need to do this. I mean, our brother's watching us all the way from Thailand right now. Jim DeJanis worked at Pelican Bay. I remember talking to Steve Duncan over the phone when I was working in Pelican Bay security squad about Jose Bat Marquez. Marquez was suspected of writing to one of our AMM members and, once again, Pelican Bay. Do you remember that conversation? And can you tell us a little bit about Bat? Because I want to bring you back to have an episode only on Bat. Can you tell us a little bit about this, Steve?
Yeah. You know, in 1996, I think it was, we went up to Pelican Bay. And I was dealing with Jim and Devin Hawks and others, you know. And they were like our heroes in that squad, you know, up there. You know, you know, we had a good relationship and they told us what was going on. At the time, they had two dropouts, Droopy Davis and who was that sick bastard from Oceanside? Roy Boy Rivas. So I go up there with the U.S. attorney, who's a freaking dingbat. You know, she's a flaming communist liberal. She probably tells Jim, why don't you give these guys teddy bears or stuffed animals so they can hold on to something, you know, and they can comfort something, you know? And I have to work with this lady because she's been assigned by the U.S. Attorney Alan Burson to work with me to do the case against the Logan guys that killed the Cardinal in Guadalajara, right? Because Mexico didn't do their job, so we had to do it here. So this lady is a fucking dingbat. I mean, she knows how to put a case together. But we go up there and we debrief Roy Boy and we debrief Droopy Davis. And they know more about David Barone and what's going on in Mexico than anybody in San Diego. You know, there's letters that David's sending up there, you know, $50 money orders. You know, he's taking care of the big homies, you know. So we learned a lot up in Pelican Bay. Stuff that you didn't think you would know, you know, you're going to a prison that's almost 1,000 miles away, you know, and these guys have been locked up, but David's communicating with them, you know, and Bat is involved with the organization from time to time, you know, when he's not in jail, and, you know, he's communicating, and, you know, and there's a strategy that all the, you know, strong soldados or soldiers who aren't the gatos, I don't know if you could find one, are going to go join David and get a piece of, you know, the Arellanos, which is, you know, it's kind of far-fetched, but, you know, that was their strategy at the time. But we learned more up in Pelican Bay than we did on the streets in San Diego, you know, about David, because David was our target. So thank you, Jim.
Hey, Steve, you know what? Like I said, man, time is our worst enemy, but I'm not going to ask you to promise, Steve, but I'm going to, hopefully, we're going to talk later, have you back. My God, these stories are fascinating. I told these guys earlier, I go, the 1 hour and a half or the hour show is going to feel like 5 minutes. And it did, without a doubt. But with that said, Bobby, any last words for Steve?
It's great having you on, Steve. I know, like I said, we met Bobby back in the late 90s and everything else. And I think some of the things we talk about is just, would love to have you back on again. This is it brings back a lot of memories for sure. A lot of death happened back then, and it continues to stay. So thanks for joining us.
Oh, thank you for having me, guys. It's a pleasure to be among heroes.
Thank you, brother. Doug, last words?
Yeah, hey, Steve, it was nice talking with you again. Good seeing you with you again. And it's nice to hear again about your experiences working those cases, because those are cases I could never have worked.
You could have.
Well, I mean,
you're smart. Without a doubt. Yeah.
But that wasn't my forte.
Yeah.
It wasn't mine either.
Yes, it was.
But these are things that young officers should hear. That, like, yeah. I said earlier, it's like you don't know where your career is going to take you, and you make the best of what it is, and you do the best job that you can do, and these are the types of results that you get. And it doesn't matter what agency you're from; it could be from any agency at all. And if you have the opportunity, do it. And thanks again, Steve. And you know what? I loved working with you. We had a lot of fun together.
We did.
Hey, Steve, once again, brother, I will reach out to you this week so we can look at your calendar. Hopefully you could come back next month sometime. If you're available, we would love to have you back. And if you're ever bored at home on a Wednesday, you want to have a beer with us, you know what? Just give me a call and you'll come right in and we'll continue where we left off, brother.
That sounds good. That sounds good.
Thank you, brother. Great, actually. Thank you, and God bless you. And my best to your children, please, to your wife. All
right, I will. All right, thank you. Thanks, Steve. Everybody out there listening. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Steve.
Thanks.
Wow, what a legend, huh?
Wow, that's good. Like I said, I think I first met Steve when I was at the judge unit, which was a juvenile. It was called Juvenile Jurisdictions United for Drug and Gang Enforcement. And it was out of the probation office, and we were cross-sworn basically as probation officers and police officers. And Steve was in GSU, and that's when I first started working with him. And he taught me a lot because I didn't know anything about how probation worked. And then to see him go to Cal DOJ and work in BNE, the Bureau of Narcotic Enforcement. And on that note, there's no longer a BNE, by the way, if people out there don't know. It got disbanded after Brown became the governor of California. But BNE was the first dedicated narcotic law enforcement agency in the United States. Long before Customs, long before DEA, it was Cal, DOJ, BNE, and Steve was part of that team.
Wow, I did not know that, man. Nah. Yeah. Hey, guys, Bobby, next week, guess who's coming back? He reached out to me last night. I didn't get a chance to talk to him today. We got Warden Danny Hernandez back next week. Danny, nice, Hernandez. Nice.
That was great.
And you know what? If it's okay with you, Doug, if you could join us next Wednesday with as a co-host with us, the reason why is because he's going to talk about the Robert Alton Harris case.
Oh, yeah.
The Robert Alton Harris case. Bobby, if you don't know that case, I'm telling you, it is going to – we're going to start off when he became the warden at St. Quentin. And he's going to talk about the 10 years of warden in St. Quentin. And then he wants to book with us one last episode on legends in CDC. And he wants to break down the legends that he worked with in the California Department of Corrections. But next week, if you could do us a favor, Doug, if you could do a lot of research, send me pictures on Robert Alton Harris about how he murdered one of our detective's sons, and yeah, how that case, so you could brief us on it. And then he'll be talking about, he's the one that gave him his last meal. He's the one that heard his last words, and he's the one that pressed the button to kill that son of a bitch.
I'll find it all out for you, Dave.
It's going to be a great episode. With that said, Bobby, any last words, man? What a night. What a night. Go ahead, Bobby.
It was great. You know, one thing, and real quick, and listening to what Steve said, I love what he said, that when he had nothing to do and he's doing paperwork, how he would go over and look at the tips that were coming in. Because yes, in this type of business, to be successful, you've got to develop sources and develop leads. And, you know, I used to always like to tell, when I was in NARCS, I would tell our secretaries, any Spanish speakers calling in with a tip, send it to me when I'm in the office, because I wanted to listen and try to cultivate sources. So for any of the young guys out there listening, it's a must. To be successful in this business, you got to network with other investigators and try to develop. You got to sort through a lot of bullshit but you get these good leads, but it's key to develop sources. So outstanding show. Love this guy, man.
Outstanding. And Doug, I don't know if you remember, but Danny Warden Vasquez, he was the parole agent in 1970 for he supervised Cheyenne Cardenas. When you see the movie American Me, Okay. He's the one that supervised him, and not only supervised him, but he sent him to prison for possession of a gun parole violation when they killed him, I believe December 18th, 1972, in Palm Hall. So he talked about that. So this guy that's coming on, Danny Vasquez, for the second time, a legend of legends, man. It's going to be a great show. Last words, Doug?
Hey, guys, just thanks for inviting me to co-host. I enjoyed it. It was nice seeing Steve again. Good talking to you guys. And anytime, I'll be more than happy to come on and listen to these stories again, because it's just fantastic. I love them.
Yeah, outstanding. Guys, with that said, we leave it with our theme song. God bless you guys. Have a great weekend. And we'll see you next Wednesday at 5 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. Here we go.
Seguir.